We live.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's a beautiful day.
Yes.
Turned out to be wonderful. Yes. A lot of people didn't make it, but we're here. We made it through another week. Yes. Thank the Lord. A lot of people didn't, but we did. So we have another day, another week to get it right and bless God and do something for somebody nice, encourage somebody. Do something wonderful. We're here, so other people might need to be encouraged also.
Yes.
Do something, pay it forward or something. God is good. He brought us through this COVID, and we just doing good, looking good, feeling good. Y'all feeling good?
Amen.
Feeling good.
Yes.
Looking good.
Feeling good.
So welcome everybody to Harborside 10 o'clock service.
Amen.
Welcome everybody online and those here in person. It ain't Easter no more, but y'all still here.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. So today I'm going to be talking a little bit about making peace with trouble. Mm-hmm. Okay. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. John 16:33. Making peace with trouble. We were almost home when I noticed it. The needle of our car's temperature gauge was rocketing up. As we pulled in, I killed the engine and hopped out. Smoke rose from the hood. The engine sizzled like bacon. I backed the car up a few feet and found a puddle of oil. Instantly, I knew what had happened. The head gasket had blown. I groaned. We just sunk money into other expensive repairs. Why can't things just work? I grumbled bitterly. Why can't things just stop breaking? Can you relate? Sometimes we avert one crisis, solve one problem, pay off one big bill, only to face another. Sometimes those troubles are much bigger than an engine self-destructing, an unexpected diagnosis, an untimely death, or a terrible loss. In those moments, we yearn for a world less broken, less full of trouble. That world Jesus promised is coming, but not yet. In this world, you will have trouble. He reminded his disciples in John 16, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Jesus spoke in that chapter about grave trouble, such as persecution of your faith, but such trouble, he taught, would never have the last word for those who hope in him. Trouble, small and large, may dog our days, but Jesus' promise of a better tomorrow with him encourages us not to let our troubles define our lives today. So let not your heart be troubled. And as we go through life, we're going to face troubles, trials, tribulations. We're going to face all of those things. And you know we are because we have. But it's how you react to those troubles. You have to let God handle those troubles. And if you're going to handle them, then you're going to mess it up. I always talk about that. Let go and let God. Let him surrender your troubles to him and he'll fix it. Also, the devil walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, and that's us. So if we're not strong in the word, he's going to run around and devour us. But as long as we stay connected to God, like I always say, then no weapon formed against us shall prosper. He has a conversation with God and says, okay, how about Marquita? I'm going to take that car away from her, and I bet you she won't love you no more. And Marquita still loves him, and he smiles at the devil and says, no, that's my child. She loves me. Then he'll say, okay, let me take that house, let me take that man away from her. I bet she ain't going to love you then. So Marquita still loves God after that. And so that's why he smiles upon us and he wants us to pass those tests. Those are the tests and trials and tribulations that we're going to go through, just some of them. But we have to hold steady to God's unchanging hand because he loves us no matter what. No matter what we've done, no matter what's in the past, we throw it all away and God died on the cross for us to save us from all of our sins. But we have to trust and give our hope and our give our glory to him, and he will handle it. Also, when it seems that problems are close, which they stay close, and we seem like we can't get rid of them, they're close, our Heavenly Father is even closer.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. Joy to be glad. Why don't you just stand here and read? Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many of you know that if you don't have your pinky toe, you lose balance and you cannot walk?
That's right.
We need every part of the body, and you are a part of the body of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Please know that without you, there's no balance in the body. I can't get nobody to talk back to me.
Come on, you got it. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes, yes. Yes.
Okay, hallelujah. It's just me cutting. I don't bother some of y'all. Hang in there with me, okay? What I tell y'all last week, I said, God gonna send us some music where I ain't gotta wait on no instrumental to start, okay? Yes, I'm gonna do it this way. But since this is praise and worship, and we don't really need no music to worship, why don't you just lift your hands and tell him thank you?
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Oh God, open up your mouth and tell him thank you.
Thank you, Lord God.
For this
Hallelujah.
Is the day.
You're worthy, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank
Hallelujah.
You, Father. Praise you, Lord
Hallelujah.
God.
That's your name. You are worthy, God.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
There we go. The devil thought he had it.
Hey,
you're
worthy, Jesus.
But God, hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
He always makes a way out of no way. He sends a ram.
Hallelujah. Yes, he does.
Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus, in this place.
7:14, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would that I do, I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Mm-hmm. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For it will, for to will its present with me.
Yeah.
But how to perform that which is good, I find not.
Yeah.
For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now, if I do that I would not, it is no more that I do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. May the God add a blessing to the reading of his word. And I'd just like to state that Pastor Q is dedicating this service to the rapper DMX.
Whatever you're looking for.
Mercy. Pray for your word this morning, Father God, that you may be with us. So, Father God, be with my mouth, my tongue, that you may be glorified and edified in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. I wanted to dedicate a big piece of this service to rapper DMX. He definitely listened to his music, helped me through some hard times in prison and even out of prison. I had a word that God had given me. I was watching all of the different things on YouTube, Facebook, they were posting about what DMX was introduced to, crack cocaine at the age of 14. And it seems that had been a struggle over his life until he died at the age of 50, what he was introduced to. And that's all they're talking about is when he was introduced to crack cocaine. Nobody is talking about the fact that he had a grandmother and a mother who introduced him to prayer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now that's the part I want to talk about, because all the media is talking about is him being introduced to crack cocaine, but nobody's talking about the fact that he got introduced to prayer and got introduced to God. And while he was doing crack cocaine, he never gave up on prayer. He never gave up on prayer. I mean, if you listen to rapper DMX, you know everywhere he went, he prayed. Even to his dying days, last interviews, he talked about prayer. He talked about being introduced to crack cocaine, but nobody glorified the fact that he was introduced to prayer, introduced, and he had a relationship with Christ.
Yes, yes.
The Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart. He never departed from prayer. He may never have departed from his addiction, but he never departed from prayer.
That's right, yes.
Let me tell you something. We all are type of prodigal sons, that we all have a seed of righteousness that's inside of us. DMX had a seed of righteousness that you used to go to church. Uh-huh. Those years of going to church when somebody had to drag you to church, yeah. You didn't know that there was a seed of righteousness being instilled,
that's right,
installed
that's
in you,
right?
That even when you tried to get away, you couldn't go too far. It's because of the seed of righteousness that you had. Somebody taking you to Bible school, taking you to Sunday school, dragging you into church. And regardless of what you went through or been through, you never gave up on your relationship with God. Nobody knew about your secret relationship with God. They only knew about your external addictions, but never knew what your internal thing that kept you going, the thing that you were wrestling with and fighting with. I had Ms. Javi read out of Romans 7 because Paul said that he also had a thorn and had something that he was wrestling with. He talked about it in Romans 7, but it picked up in the book of Corinthians when he said that the devil had given him a thorn in the flesh. And he said he had besought the Lord 3 times for that. And God said, no, my grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in weakness. I saw and heard through DMX music that he sought the Lord for his addiction to crack cocaine. And God never removed it. Paul had a thorn in the flesh that he sought God for. And guess what? God never removed it. He said, my grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Have you ever known that something that you have been introduced to earlier in your childhood is still there?
Yeah.
And God still has not taken it away.
Yeah.
He said he gives us temperance. Temperance is just another fancy word for self-control. Paul said, even when I did good, evil was present with me.
Yeah.
You got to understand, even when I'm serving God, that the evil is present with me because I'm still in the flesh.
Yeah.
We always talk about deliverance, but let me tell you that you serve a God who doesn't always remove the thing out of you. He doesn't always do that. See, some of us are still, you got to understand how God works. And this is definitely on the prophetic. God allowed Paul to have something that he knew was going to keep him crying and running out to him. God has allowed you to have something that's going to keep you close to him. Though it seems like an addiction, it's something that God has that's going to keep you crying out to him. Matter of fact, Paul received the thorn in the flesh to keep him humble. But, you know, God allows you to have something that he knows is going to keep you next to him. Something that doesn't make you feel better than everybody else. Something that you know, it is something that dwells in you that you want to get rid of. You pray about it all the time, and he still doesn't remove it. Because if he had removed it, he would remove you from him. Because he knows that if I remove all the things in you that you struggle with, I will basically remove the relationship. God said, it's for your good that I give you something that causes you to cry out to me. Because if you had nothing, you wouldn't cry out. Oh, yeah. God says, I have to allow you to be able to have a thorn in the flesh. I have to be able to allow you to have something that they can't cure. Allow you to have something that they can't remove. Allow something you to have something that makes you feel different than everybody else. And guess what God says? I'm not removing it because I allow you to have it. I am the creator of all things. I taught a few weeks ago about Saul. Not this Saul, Saul from Samuel, Saul that Saul, not Saul that became Paul. God allowed him to be able to have a depressing or distressing spirit.
Right, right.
That distressing spirit made him get into worship. And the Bible says every time he got into worship, the distressing spirit left him.
Yes.
If God did not give him that distressing spirit, he would never get into worship.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, one of the cures to ADD and depression and anxiety is to get into worship. God has given me something that when I feel heavy and I feel low, if I get into worship, we have got into popping pills. We have got into finding something to help me deal with that. God, we have found every vice, and God says, the vice to that is going to help you deal with your depression, your anxiety, your stress is to get into worship. I've allowed you to be able to have something that forces you to be able to get into worship. Bible says that God allowed Paul to have the devil to give him this thorn in the flesh. And Paul said he prayed about it. God says, my grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Mm-hmm. Meaning that I know what you have, but what you have is going to keep you close to me. Mm-hmm. I've been looking at all the things about DMX. They're playing this music, and I see that he was never able to kick the addiction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Never able to kick the addiction. But the thing about it is he never had given up on his prayer life.
Amen.
He continued to pray, continued to wrestle. Amen. Let me tell you what, DMX didn't have the type of Christian life that would be boasted upon, but it's the type of Christian life that we all go through. We all are serving God and struggling with something at the same time. Whether we're struggling with lust, addiction, unforgiveness, we're all serving God with something that should not be there, but we have the Spirit of God that keeps us in it. Listen what he says. Let's go into the teaching, Romans chapter 7. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice, but what I hate that I do. I don't believe that DMX, I don't believe that anybody else like doing anything that they addicted to, but they understand that it's a wrestling, it's a struggle. The Bible teaches us walk in the Spirit, and you should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, against and the Spirit against the flesh. And by this, you cannot do the things that you would. There's always a struggling. There's always a wrestling that's going up inside of us. Even after you get saved, the struggle becomes greater.
Yes.
I believe it was Rebecca that God said she had two nations tied up in her womb, Esau and Jacob, right?
Yes.
You got to get blessed by this teaching.
Yes.
See, the Bible just says she had twins, but God said it's not that you're just having twins. You have two nations inside of you.
Yes.
The two nations was to represent the Muslims and to represent the Christians, right? Because Esau went and still served God, and then you still had Jacob serving God, but they served God differently, but they both served the same God. But she said, you have two different nations inside of your womb. And she said, this is what she said, but God told her something. He said that the older will serve the younger.
Yes.
It should be such a way, because how is the firstborn going to serve the secondborn? And the Bible says, it gave us an account that when the firstborn was born, which was Esau, it says that as he was coming out of the mother's womb, that Jacob grabbed him by the heel, I believe. And it was a spiritual thing. He says, listen, the older son is going to end up serving the younger son. Nobody really got what God was saying. What God was trying to teach is that you, not only do you have two different nations, but you have two different people warring inside of you. And the spiritual side is that I need to get the older to serve the younger. You got to understand, the younger is the promise. The younger is the promise. You got to understand that Abraham had two baby mamas, right? But the promise came through the second baby mama, not the first one. God, the first shall be last, the last shall be first. God says that the elder is going to serve the younger. Your older self is going to serve your newer self, bringing your flesh under subjection. That's why the Bible tells us to desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby.
Right.
When you receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, notice the Bible said that you are babes in Christ, but it's your responsibility to feed that babe in Christ in you so that you can make your older self serve your younger self.
Yes, come on.
Yeah. I don't know how old the baby Jesus that is inside of you, but he still shouldn't be baby Jesus.
Right.
One day you have to take him off the breast, take him off the Pedialyte. You're going to have to give him some solid food, because you have your baby Jesus wrestling with a grown man or grown woman, and that's why you continue to lose that battle, because the baby Jesus that dwells in you is malnutrition. Desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby.
Yes.
God says you have something in you that needs to be fed. Walk in the Spirit, you should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You got to understand, God gives us a free will. But he says, listen, if I allow your older self to keep jacking your younger self up, one day your younger self is going to get tired and it's going to start to eat more. When he's saying eat more, he's talking about the manna. When he's saying eat more, he's talking about the word. If I learn to build up my younger self, I will be able to get a hold of my older self. Notice when they teach you about anything with healing, they say, listen, let's deal with the old you first. When you go to any type of class, 12 steps, whatever it may be, and they're talking to you, they say, let's deal with your older self first. Let's allow your younger self, your younger self to get a hold of your older self, because that's what the problem is. For what I'm doing, I do not understand. Honey, how many of us are dealing with something we do on a daily basis, we do not understand why we keep doing it? Yeah, I don't understand why I keep doing it, understand why I keep going back, understand why I can't stay offline, understand why I can't shake this thing. I don't even understand, but I just keep on doing it. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. The good that I should be doing, I'm not practicing it. But he says, but what I hate that I do. How many of us are doing something that we hate? And we just continue to do it, though we hate it, though we know what it's doing to us. Listen, some of us get up and say, I don't know why I keep doing that.
That's right.
Oh, Paul's going to tell us why we keep doing it. He says, if then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. There is something that is dwelling in me that I agree with that it is good. Listen to what it says. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. When I used to read verse 17, I used to think that Paul was not accepting responsibility for his actions, because he says it's no longer I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. What Paul was talking about was, he says that the scripture, I am a new creation in Christ. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. He says, who am I in God? That's not me anymore. But I recognize that the new me dwells in an old body. That's not me that's doing that. Yeah, I am performing the work, but that's not me. You got to understand that that's not who God called me to be. I'm performing and doing something that God did not call me to do. That's not me. When I say that's not me, it's not that I'm not taking responsibility. This is not the man or woman of God that he has called me to be. That is my unrighteousness. That's something that needs to be cleaned up. This is not who he has called me to be. Paul says, it's not that I'm not accepting responsibility. I'm just saying this is not me. How many have times you have to look yourself in the mirror and say, this is not me? I got to get out of this place because this is not me.
Yes.
Sometimes you got to look things in the mirror and say, listen, this is not me. You got me messed up. This ain't who he has called me to be. The prodigal son came to a place in the place of the pig pen, and he said, this is not me. This is not my father has hired servants that are eating better than this. This is not me. Sometimes you come out of a place and God say, yeah, this is not me. I've been in this place for way too long, but I woke up today saying, this is not me. This is not what he has for me. I've come to Bible say he came to himself. Consciousness set in. Holy Spirit set in. He said, you know what? I may have allowed myself to be in this situation, but guess what? This is not me. I've settled, but this is not me. Look at what he says. For I know that is in me, that is in my flesh. He recognizes, you know what? I recognize there's nothing good that's inside of this flesh. DMX had this album called Flesh of My Flesh, Blood of My Blood.
Yes.
Also had another album called It's Dark and Hell is High. The whole time he thought he was putting out music, he was giving them scripture.
Yes.
But see, he's not the type of Christian rapper that's going to be on 104.1. Get blessed. See, that's the type of Christian rapper, Brother Bruce, I listen to. See, them Christian rappers y'all listen to just keep rapping a whole bunch of Bible scriptures. I don't want to hear that. I'm being honest. I don't want to hear it. Something I don't want to hear. I don't want to hear you put the whole Bible into a rap. I don't want to hear it. What I do want to hear is what you're going through.
Yeah.
And I want to hear that when you're not, I want to hear you curse because you're performing without cursing, you're preaching without cursing, but that ain't your real life. I want you to talk to me about the real stuff that you do and say. I don't want to hear no Christian rap. I don't want to watch no Christian movies. I don't want to go to Christian bowling parties. I don't want to go to Christian events. I want to be around people who being real and showing their unrighteousness. I want to be around. I don't want to listen to that Christian music. I want to hear Scarface and DMX, and I want to hear Scarface say, I've never seen a man cry till I seen a man die. Yeah. That's Christian rap to me. I want to hear Bone Thugs and Harmony say, meet me at the crossroads. Come on, now that's Christian rap to me. That's what I come up on. That's what had me crying in the car on the way home from the black hole. I want to hear Tupac sing Dear Mama. That's Christian rap to me. I don't want to hear y'all keep rapping Hezekiah. That ain't for me. It might be for you, not for me. See, the thing about it is, you see, DMX and God was using people who could not make 104.1 and could not make those stations. Oh, let me tell you what God will do. Come on, vessels down. If I can't allow your music to make the Christian station, I will use you. Come on. DMX was considered to be a hardcore rapper. And guess what was in the music? Nothing but prayers. Look how sneaky God can be. He was putting his word in secular music, knowing that other people won't even listen to Christian music. So God says, what I'll do, I'll allow you to make it, but I'll allow you to keep a thorn in your flesh. I will give you something that allows you not to be able to escape me. You think it's pain, it's not even pain. It's something that keeps you connected to me. I will allow you to have it. Because DMX, as long as I allow you to have the addiction, that way I can get more of me through you, through your addiction. You don't even know that he works through your addiction. My grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in weakness. So Paul says, since your strength is made perfect in weakness, I'm going to boast in my infirmity.
Yes.
Meaning that I'm going to glorify God for the weaknesses that I have.
Yes.
Listen, I don't want to go to no church where I can't boast about my weaknesses.
Yes. Yes.
You can't even tell them what's going on in church today. It set you down.
That's right.
You're shacking up, you can't be in the choir. You pregnant, you can't usher. You got too many tattoos, you can't read the scripture. Your hair red, your hair blue. I done dyed my hair and lost my position in the church at the same time. And guess what? I got more righteousness than all of you. I don't want to go to them type of churches or be a part of that nonsense.
Yeah.
Having the form of godliness, but deny the power thereof.
Yeah.
The real wolves in sheep's clothing. Yeah. I come to you as the sheep looking like the wolf.
Yeah.
God says, okay, I'm going to put my word into hip hop.
Yeah.
You Christian people, right? You don't listen to rap music that has cursing in it, but watch TV with cursing in it.
Yes.
I'm sick of it. Sick of it. Turn this down, turn that off. But everything you watching on HBO is filthy. Don't listen to that stuff with me in here. All your shows are filthy. Just have a form of godliness, deny the power thereof.
Yeah.
God, he talked about you having your own righteousness. Your righteousness is as filthy rags.
Yeah.
And now they're going, now you know what's crazy? DMX done died, now they're going back replaying all the music, and now they hear all the prayers. Then you say you're nobody until somebody kill you.
Yeah.
Wow. You gotta listen, you gotta understand what God is saying. I have to die for you to play my music?
Yeah.
Now it's on every station.
Yeah.
Guess what the word says? Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies to itself, it cannot bear much fruit.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're gonna glorify God more in your death, let me teach you.
Yeah.
Yeah. DMX in the hospital, life support. in White Plains, they had the whole White Plains Hospital circle around with people praying for him. Mm-hmm. And you know what though? This was right. This is great teaching, right? All the prayers in the world, and he still passed. Not my will, that you. It don't mean that prayer didn't work. God says, I just use him to gather y'all. You gotta understand that though Jesus was on the cross, he said, I'm gonna bring out more people at my death. When you die, that's when they play. Now they're playing all the interviews, and guess what's in the interviews? Him praying and him having words. He said, I didn't even know that DMX was such a spiritual person. Give you beauty for ashes. Sometime you miss the word because of the presentation. The man has several albums, and the whole time he was crying out to you about his struggles and addictions. And you never heard it. You never heard it. You know why? Because of the presentation. Pastor Q, I can't listen to you. Why? Because of your presentation. Sometimes you get lost in the presentation. The prophets don't come dressed like the prophets. Prophets don't come dressed like the prophets. This is not a job interview. I don't have to dress up for something I already have. It's not a job interview. You're trying to get hired. You're trying to be accepted. Oh, well, let me tell you something so great. When you start to walk in your truth.
Come on.
And walking with who you're supposed to be, the ones that's not there will fall off.
Yes.
Every week somebody's coming to me, Pastor Q, somebody said something about what you had on and why do I follow you? Okay. Listen, 99% of the time, people was more concerned with my presentation than what was said. Jesus had the same thing because Jesus was saying some great things, but because of his presentation and him dressing like the other disciples, when they came to get him, he had to be betrayed with a kiss because they still couldn't identify him. Jesus said, who y'all looking for? They couldn't even identify him because he blended in with the rest of them. I don't care where I go, I can walk in the room and I know who's the pastor. There's something about that old suit and that hat or something he's doing. I know him in the room. And it's not because he has the Spirit of God, it's by his presentation. Listen here, I don't want to serve God by presentation. He said, you shall know a tree by the fruit, not by the way it looks. Because I'm going to teach you something you may not know. The tree of knowledge and good and evil was the best looking tree in the garden. It was the best looking tree in the garden. When the woman, she saw that it was to be desirable. It was the best looking tree. And he made the best looking tree the tree I said no to. Oh, he always makes the thing that looks good to me the no to me. It's the tree for me. It's the tree for me. It's the tree for me. See, you ain't got to like how this tree look, how it sounds. Sometimes people see you with a tree. They say, what you want with that old tree? And you said, I had a good looking tree that wasn't worth nothing. I don't know who was a Snow White or Dorothy that took from a tree. With Snow White, and they gave her an apple, and ever since they gave Snow White the apple, they put the apple in Genesis. Never said it was a shiny red apple. He said it was the tree. You should know a tree by its fruit. You better start tasting fruit for you pick trees. What they say, the tree don't fall, fruit don't fall far from the
that's
tree.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You be around them, you like them, yeah. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good doeth.
No good.
You got to know that about yourself.
No,
you got to know there's nothing good in your flesh.
Yeah.
Nothing good in your flesh. You are a new creation in Christ. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Nothing is in your flesh that is good. Nothing that in your flesh is pleasing to God. You cannot please God in the flesh. Hebrews 11 chapter 6 says, in order to please God, you must first believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Abraham had faith and it was accredited to him as righteousness. You can't please God in the flesh. You can only please God in the spirit. You, God doesn't look at your flesh. He's not pleased with your flesh.
Yeah.
Nothing in me. For to will is present with me. It's present. I mean, listen, to do good is present. It's here. I know right from wrong. It's present.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But how to perform what is good, I do not find. I have good inside of me. I'm having a hard time performing it.
Yeah.
But it's present. Good is present with me.
Yeah.
I know right from wrong. I know that what I'm not supposed to be doing, but I'm having a hard time performing righteousness.
Yeah.
Listen to what Paul says. He says, now I, for the good that I will to do, the good that I want to do, I do not do it. There's a wrestling here. I want to do good, but I can't seem to be able to perform the good that I want to do.
Yeah.
But it's present in me. And you know, when you hear a word like this, people always say, you know what? God knows my heart, right? That's what they say. They say God knows my heart because they say to will is definitely present with me. God knows my heart. I want to do the right thing. Yeah, I want to do what's right. I'm having a hard time performing which is right, but I want to do the right thing. This is Paul's struggle that he has in him. You know, some people go back in the scripture, I was talking about the Corinthians, and they talk about the thorn in the flesh which he had been given. And people believe, listen, this thorn in the flesh and what God was trying to teach us, because nobody has knows for a certainty or surely what Paul's thorn in the flesh is, but it represents us having something, God allowing us to have something that we struggle with that's going to keep us close to him.
Yeah.
And you pray that God removes that thing, he doesn't.
Yeah.
He doesn't.
Yeah.
Let me tell you what. Sometimes the deliverance that you seek is the deliverance that can remove you. See, the thing about it is, what you must understand, even that people like DMX may not, people not liking your presentation. See, Christianity is so wrong because we teach Christianity in a place that when you come to Christ, it's about making you look better.
Yeah.
It's not. It's not just about making you look better. It's about making you a servant.
Yes. Yes.
See, so the problem is, if you misteach the Bible, you will have people away from the people that they need to reach, looking better than the people that they need to reach. And then that becomes offensive, because notice this, the way the Bible is taught, it has me removing myself away from the people I need to witness to. That's the way the Bible is taught. Don't hang around them. Don't be around them. Come away from them. Don't go to that. Don't go to this. Don't go there. Don't go to a club. Don't go to a bar. Don't do this. Don't do that.
Yes.
But then they say, hey, let's go do outreach. Where?
Right.
Where?
Right.
Where's outreach going to take place?
Right.
You already said all the places we can't go. Where are we going to do outreach?
Yeah.
Guess what you find yourself doing? Outreach in your own church. How many times are people going to come up and receive Jesus Christ? I went to a church, the same people got prayed for every Sunday. The same people receive Christ every Sunday. Then when you want to do outreach, it's only okay in certain places. Pastor, he's scared to go to the hood, but he loves God. Well, if God is your protection, go ahead around Simple City. Go to East Gate. Go around Valley Green. You say God is your provider. And listen here. If you believe that God delivers Shadrach and Meshach, go to Ward 8. But your God only protects you in your church. Oh! In your own comfortable capacity. keep putting people on the street with buckets, collecting money from the church. Hidden pimping. Let me tell you what. You don't have to put people on the corner with buckets, because if you call, God will provide. What that's showing me, you're not called to do what you're supposed to be doing, because he wouldn't have to put people on the corner. The Bible tells me that, listen, if I obey the laws of God, the blessings will come and find me. People on the corner collected money for the church. It's the opposite. He says if the people were tithing right,
that's right,
there would be meat in my house. How is the church in the world trying to get meat from the world? Because ain't no meat in the house. You know why? Because the people that created churches were not called. Many are called. You were called to serve, not to open your own church. I've been in this hotel 2 years and I've seen 10 churches come and go.
That's right.
And I'm still here with the smallest congregation. I've been in ministry for 10 years with the smallest congregation and hasn't yet took a special offering. We say it once and that's it.
Thank you, Lord.
Because let me tell you what, God provides. Yeah, yeah. When it ain't for you to do, you put them on the corner. You got to keep asking over and over again during the service. Some of us stop going to church because we tired of them begging. God ain't sent me here for you to get it from me. If you know him, you can get it from him. Oh, see, the insecurity shows me the fact that you're asking me for something is the fact that you don't know him. Because he said, I will supply all of your needs according to the riches that's in Christ Jesus. I know the things you need and want before you even ask them. That's how I know you're doing something wrong with your ministry. You're not called to do it, because if you called, you wouldn't beg. Here's great teaching, right? How many people helped Noah build the ark? I'll wait. God gave him all the gopher wood.
Yes,
guess what they teaching? God gave him all the people. Listen what I said. God didn't give Noah the people. He gave him all the what? Gopher wood. But nowadays, we need people to bring gopher wood. If you need people to bring gopher wood, you're not called. Because God gave a man all the supplies he needed.
Yes.
You're not called to do this thing. And that's why you have such a great need. The strangle of a pastor to know he has to get up here and preach, knowing that he has to preach hoping that they can pay the next month's rent. That's because you're not called to do it. Yeah, because God provides. If you were doing what you're supposed to be doing. I can boast in God about that. Having the smallest ministry, but still being able to maintain. Without taking any special offers, I can boast in God on that. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. It's a struggle. We're all going to deal with spiritual warfare in this Christ walk. Be okay with dealing and battling. Don't be okay with sinning, but be okay knowing that whatever God, whatever you're struggling with, it's okay. Let me tell you, when you serve a God, listen, the Bible's King David asked God to give him, create in him a clean heart. And renew a right spirit within him. Yet that's what he asked God for. Just because God changes your heart, that does not change your flesh. Some of us have different, let me teach you something about God. You may have never known this before. Though you be delivered from something else, you know that there's something else still there. He can deliver you from nicotine and find out there's something else there. God can constantly deliver you from things that you feel like you're doing and just to find out there's something else that's still there. Because truly, in your flesh, there can never be a true deliverance in your flesh. But you can be whole. When the Bible talks about, people disagree with this teacher. Yes. In the book of James, where he talks about you shall be mature, you shall be complete, you shall be perfect. Perfect meaning mature. He's talking about the spiritual man.
Yes.
You're always going to have a desire. Listen, if you don't have a desire to do wrong, you're a robot. You have a desire right now to do something. If somebody dropped $100, your first thought should be to keep it. Oh, you're not human. The second, no, I'm not going to do that. Because it's going to come by here, ma'am, you dropped this.
That's right.
But the flesh always wars. I should respond, but no.
That's right.
Every day you wake up and you choose not to deal with something that's inside of you. Well, guess what? Every time you choose not to deal with something that's inside of you or to entertain it, you kill it. That was the real reason of fasting. Fasting was not set to get what you want from God. Fasting was to set, was to kill what you're asking God for. Keep fasting to get what you want. A lot of times what you're asking for is not of God and does not come from a place of God. So hopefully fasting will kill that thing. Because listen, the Bible says you have not because you ask not, but you have not because you ask amiss that you may receive these things upon your own selfish lusts. There's some things we keep asking about and praying about. Sometimes it's not God that's saying, no, it's not for the season. God says you must understand there is a lust that is praying right along with you. For we do not know the things that we ought to pray for, but the Spirit itself make up intercession with us with groanings that cannot be uttered. Even when I'm praying for the wrong thing, the Spirit steps, listen, if you want to understand what it looks like when you pray, if you ever go to a restaurant with a kid, the kid is going to order something off the menu that he cannot eat.
That's right.
Or something he cannot afford, and his mother has to say, no, he will have the chicken nuggets. He's picked the whole sirloin.
That's right.
Mama say, no, give him the crayons, the applesauce, and the chicken nuggets. That is intercession at its finest.
Yes.
Somebody stepping in. Listen, you got this thing in you that when you ask for something, it says, God, no, that's not, no. No, that's not what we need.
Yeah.
This is what we need.
Thank you, Lord.
Because when you want something, God says, I supply the need according to the riches that's in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
You pointing for something, you can't have that. You can't, matter of fact, you don't even have a digestive system. Because see, the problem is, I don't know, but the older I've gotten, I'm learning about myself. I'm learning that I need different type of milks. I need soy milk and lactose. Yeah, I learned that as I got older. So now before I order, I have to find out what's inside of what you're serving. I hope you hear me. I got to find out what that's made with. You ever have somebody serve you something? They say, do you have any food allergies?
Yeah.
Because they're trying to let you know that what's inside of you can cause you to be sick.
Yeah.
Listen, it's not that what you're asking for is not for you. It has to be prepared differently.
Yeah.
Listen, he told them in the Old Testament, when he told them to mark the door of the house with the blood of the Lamb, he told them how, Brother Bruce, to prepare the lamb.
Yeah. Yes.
Prepare the lamb this way.
Yeah.
It can't have certain stuff in it. He said, when you make your bread, it has to be made without what? Yeast. Why is he so in detail into the preparation of what's made? He said, it's not saying, I'm not telling you what you can't have. I'm saying you can't have that with that in it.
Yeah.
Listen what he's saying. I'm not saying no to what you're asking me for, but you're asking me for something that has something in it that's not good for you. But let me remake it. And when I make it, I'm going to send it to you. So the thing that you're eating won't harm you. He's not saying no to that. He's saying because of what's in it.
Yeah.
That thing will hurt your stomach.
Yeah.
Yeah. that thing will have you cramping all night. You can't do that.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Let me go a little deeper. You know you're dark versus white. I'm talking to somebody. You know how you act off the dark versus how you act off the white. I'm talking liquor for the people that say it.
Okay.
You know you can't do that. You know what's in that. You know that brings something out of you.
That's right.
Not that anymore. Sometimes people don't even know what you're saying no to.
That's right.
Once I get there. To you the next day, you already know, you ain't gonna smell right after, you already know, but you said, I'm still gonna have it, I already know what it's gonna produce.
That's right, yes.
Taking Tums in my Atlanta with you, knowing that thing gonna make that stomach cut up. Oh Lord, let me finish this. Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find in a law that evil is present with me. I find in a law that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. Listen to what he's saying. It's spiritual welfare. In my inward man, I delight in the law of the Lord. Delight. Notice when it said the word delight, he said that if you delight in the Lord, he would give you the desires of your heart. Yeah. That comes from a delighting first in the Lord. He says, I want to do the will of God. I want to go to church. I want to serve God. I want to do what is right. The biggest battle, as I found out even with DMX and a lot of us, what we go through, the biggest fight that you fight is, they say, is the enemy breaks down to the inner me. Sometimes it's not even people that you're up against. You're up against the battle of your own self. Yeah. Every day we fight with ourselves. I have to tell myself no. Paul said in the scripture, he said, I beat my flesh. I have to beat my flesh into subjection. Yes. Into subjection. I have to. This bad thing about life is that when you come into Christ, you have to say no to things that you like.
Yeah,
that's spiritual warfare. Yeah. But every time you say no to something, you build on your discipline.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And then you're able to say no again.
Yeah.
It's because you're killing the thing in you that desires it.
Yeah.
That's the enemy. Sometimes the enemy is yourself.
Yeah.
You war and fight. You're on your own way. Mm-hmm. You the thing about it is, I'm going to tell you what's such a great teaching. We blame everybody, right? And the thing about blaming everybody, you'll find yourself around nobody. Uh-huh. This is such great teaching. And then you'll find out that you was the problem. Uh-huh. Yeah, you're the problem.
Yeah.
Once you has ran everybody away from you, it forces you to look at you. Dealing with self. For I delight in the law of God out the inner man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. In a deeper teaching as well, Paul is talking about living free in Christ, right? But also he's talking about, as he's living free in Christ, he recognizes that he still has the Ten Commandments warring inside of him. The Bible says, talks about if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. It gets tricky because Paul said, I see the Ten Commandments working in my body, reminding me of the sin that I have. But he's telling me to live free in the Spirit. I'm no longer captive by the law, but he's still telling me, listen, when people says, God says that's the Old Testament versus New, God didn't say all this stuff not to mean it. But let me tell you the difference. When you look at the Ten Commandments, and actually there's more than 10. When you look at them, you'll find that they're inside of the commandments, you'll find that it's almost impossible to please God. Okay? This is a teaching. Inside the commandments, it's impossible to please God because all of our faults are in the commandments. So in that case, since the Bible says in the book of James, if you break one, you break them all, because the way he wrote the law, I'm always going to be a sinner. Because every day I'm going to break the law. So those who try to keep the law, even they fail, because it's impossible to wake up and not break one of the commandments. So when they brought the woman to Jesus and she was caught in a very act of adultery, Jesus says, let him who have no sin cast the first stone. Because it's impossible every day to live without breaking the law. You may have not committed any type of sin this morning, but because he has said obey the law of the land, you were definitely over 55.
That's right.
You didn't stop at the stop sign. You ran through some reds. And some of us are driving on a suspended. So though you didn't shoot, kill, and do none of those things, you have broken other laws. And you showed up to church this morning feeling good. But if we go through all the commandments, you deserve to be stoned. But because we have our misdemeanors and felonies in the Bible, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is no misdemeanors or felonies in this book. God says the law is made the way it's made, so you will always find a sin of yours inside of it. And that means you need a savior. Why do I need a savior? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Every day there's a bill. You know when you go into a restaurant and you say you can bring the check and they list all the things that you had. This is such great teaching, right? Because when you go to the restaurant and you stare at the bill and you're like, but the spiritual teaching about your restaurant bill is that you receive the bill and you're trying to find out who some of the stuff belonged to. I had this, but I didn't have that. I shouldn't be charged for this. I sent that back. You notice that we happily eat and get the bill and the mood change? This is what God does. God says, okay, every day, if I send you an invoice for your sin, and the wages of sin is death, you can't pay that bill. And you can't do dishes either. How you gonna pay that? There's two different types of payments I will receive. The first payment I will receive is the blood. Yeah. After you have the blood and you run that bill up, the second payment is confession. The first payment is the blood. The second payment is confession. If we confess our faults with one another, confession. He's faithful to forgive us of our sins. Confession is this for the second invoice. The first invoice, you need the blood. That's how it works. So when you get the bill, you don't have to stare at it, because it's going to happen. When you die, you're going to get the bill, when he's going to say, how do you pay for all of these sins? I love it when you go out. I got to close. I love it when you go out and has anybody ever gotten a gift card for a particular restaurant? Let me give it to you like this, right?
You know that in order for you to have a gift card, somebody had to pay for your meal. Hold up now. In order to have a gift card, that means that somebody went ahead of your bill and paid for your food before you even sat down. Hold up, somebody thought enough about you and know that you like Outback enough and saw your life and said, I'm going to get you an Outback gift card because you always talking about going in. What if God got a gift card and said, I'm going to send it to you from where I know you're going. You're going to need it. And when I give you this gift card, they're going to bring you a bill. All you got to do is give them the gift card. It's already prepaid. For he is an accuser of the brethren, who accused them before the Lord day and night. You got to learn how to give the devil, who is the servant at that time, servant, the gift card, and say that which you have accused before has already been paid. For the wages of my sin is death, but the gift card in God is Christ Jesus our Lord. I already got a gift card that covers me. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but the flesh, the law of sin. Paul says, I serve him with my mind. But as I'm serving him with my mind, my flesh is trying to serve the law of sin. I dedicated to this service to the brother DMX because even a week before he died, you know, I saw an interview. He was talking about getting people to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And it was, and his whole life was a wrestle. He was on Ayanna Van Zandt. He was on things, but you know what? Toward the end, I saw him pushing toward. He always had word in him.
Thank you, Lord.
I remember when I was in prison and I used to rap, I understand what DMX went through. And the reason why it was so meant so much to me because I gotta hurry up, but real quick. My mom would tell me, I used to rap, but it didn't have any cursing in it. So when my managers took me to the record label, they said they wanted something a little more hard. They didn't want that type of rap. And it was so much word in my music. And when they took it to Sony, they were like, yeah, but it's just not hard enough. I knew what they were saying. And when I tried to do something that was hard, it just didn't feel right. And I never got nobody to pick me up for the clean rap that I was trying to do. I understood and then know now, and I thank God for it because the music industry is a different type of demon. I don't care who you know. 99.9% of your favorite singer and act singer in the music industry started off singing where? Where does everybody start off singing at? Where did the devil start off singing?
In the church.
Where did he end up singing?
Come on.
Before they got in the industry, they sung in church. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world? Remember, I taught you soul is not the spirit. Your soul is identity. The devil says, let me buy your identity. Let me use your gift for something else. I'm not saying DMX sold his soul. But the only way he could get you to listen is to talk like you. See, you don't hear God because of the swearing. But you hear the devil because of his presentation. Can't nobody talk and I'm gonna tell you, and express himself like T.D. Jakes. Not saying T.D. Jakes is the devil, but I'm gonna tell you what, that devil, his wordplay, how he speaks, how he enunciates words.
Yeah.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. And it's the devil.
Yeah.
Come on, sir.
God will speak to you
right.
where you can understand.
That's right.
It can happen. And people will say, you know what?
That's right.
That's devil music. Mm-hmm. And listen to a devil talk properly. So Jesus says, since the devil sounds like a scholar from college and has all the Bible knowledge, he says, my sheep will know my voice. Oh, hold up. He said, my sheep should know my voice, not my vocabulary. Because God didn't want to use nobody eloquent of speech, he chose Moses, who had a speech impediment. He said, it's not about how you talk. It's about what you say. You keep trying to go places and talk right. It's about what you say. Say this, I'm over time. Well, you know, have you ever tried to call and get on the phone with them people and talk white, or they say talk professional, and then don't get what you want, and you gotta bring the whole thing out? It started off like, yeah, can I get somebody some customer service, please? No, thank you. Well, we can't listen here, then you gotta go into that, right? Yeah, they didn't understand. See, y'all ain't understanding about me being proper. But when I started talking this way, I got to manage y'all here. Yeah. When Jesus went in the temple, he turned over the tables. He went in there acting real hood.
Yes, he did.
Who's Savior in the temple turning over the tables? Said, this is my Father's house.
Yes.
Y'all have made the dinner feast. Boy, if Jesus came to some of y'all churches, he wouldn't be in there praise and worship. He'd be in there turning on the table.
That's upset.
Right. That's
right.
He said they were selling doves and stuff in the temple. He walked in there, they were selling dinner, selling lotion, selling incense. He said they in church selling earrings. Let them set up tables. Pop-up shops in the lobby of the church. Jesus would come in that church and turn all them tables over. Then my Father's house should be a house of prayer. You have turned into the Compton swap meet. The Baltimore flea market. That's what the church has become. Everybody's selling you something. I done tired. At least the dinner should be free. Let us stand. Father, thank you for blessing. It is what it is. Father, we thank you for the word. Thank you for the brother Earl Sims, BMX. May God bless his soul. May the Most High be pleased with his soul. Thank you, Father God, for this word in Jesus' name. I'm the voice, Pastor Q. Thank all you guys for being a blessing. We're going forth in tithes and offers. We may have to move swiftly because we took up too much time. My fault. But thank God for this day. Amen. Yeah. Let's go. Amen. Praise.